another evening with Friday Forum. And Jyoparsi, bring this to you with the help of Parso and the Ministry of Minority Affairs. I'm happy to announce that today the status of Parsi babies who have been added to the community is around 320 babies. Another good news is that we have Theobroma family with us today, and they are going to take us on the journey of how they started and where they are. It was started by the Missmans, a Parsi family in Mumbai. As co-founders, the family has worked together to create a much-loved and best-known patisserie in India. Theobroma makes, as we all know, brownies, cakes, desserts, chocolates, and breads. They started with one small outlet in 2004 at the iconic Pushro Bagh. Theobroma currently has approximately 75 outlets in 6 cities in India. The trio behind Theobroma are a Parsi mother and her 2 daughters. Let me introduce Kainas. Ms. Kainas Missman Harchandrai. Currently, she's the creative director at Theobroma, an alumni of the the Institute of Hotel Management, Mumbai, and Oberoi Center of Learning and Development, Delhi. She was a pastry chef at Oberoi Uday Villas in Udaipur before starting Theobroma. Kainas is the face behind Theobroma and the driving force behind its success. We have Ms. Tina Missman Wykes with us, who graduated from Sikkim College of Commerce and Economics, Mumbai, and is a member of the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India. She has worked at KPMG Mumbai and New Wedge in London. Tina and Kainas have written a book about starting and growing their business and have shared the joys and challenges of their journey. Baking a Dream, the Theobroma story, is an inspiring read of overcoming obstacles and achieving one's dreams. And this book was published last year in 2020 by HarperCollins India. And we have Ms. Kamal Missman, the matriarch of the family. She ran a small business in the 90s, making brownies, cakes, desserts from home. A self-taught cook, an entrepreneur, she's the original baker of the family. Theobroma has evolved from her home business, and some of the recipes that they use even today are hers and some that she inherited from her mom. We welcome Delna Mistry Anand as the moderator today. And she is a meditation and well-being coach based in London. And at her own, she is a dedicated chocoholic. So Delna is a close family friend, and she will also share a few of her own memories and experiences of Theobroma with you today. I hand over the floor to you, Delna. All yours.
Thank you, Shamla. Thank you so much. I'm based in Dubai, by the way.
Yes.
I'm so delighted to be here today talking to my very, very dear friends on this very prestigious platform. So thank you so much, Shamla, for having me here. And thank you, Tina, Kainas, and Kamal Aunty for inviting me on this amazing platform to interview 3 most incredible women behind the brand Theobroma. I've had the pleasure of growing up with this family and seeing firsthand all the trials and tribulations and all the humble beginnings from a small one cafe. Actually, even way before it was Theobroma, I have seen it firsthand. So I'm really excited to have this conversation here today. And I think I'm going to start right away with Kainas. Kainas, you've had such an exciting and interesting story of how you got initiated into this world. So let's take it a little back. Let's go down memory lane and let's talk about the beginning. How did Theobroma come to life?
Thank you, Delna. Thank you to the entire GeoParsi Foundation for having us here today. So though I grew up watching my mom in the food business and taking part in that business, initially I never wanted to follow in her footsteps. It was something that I took for granted. It was always part of my life and, you know, I never really thought about it as a career option. I always wanted to be a lawyer. And I had my heart set on pursuing law. Then at the age of 16, I had an opportunity to go to France as a Rotary Youth Exchange student. And actually, it took me time to be time away from home to actually realize and actually go back to my roots. Because whilst I was in France, I spent time with families who had fruit gardens. So I would spend my afternoons reading under fruit trees. I bunked school and I used to go and spend all my money in pastry shops, eating bread and pastries. And it was a very exciting time. And whilst I was in France, I realized that it was, such a joy to eat for pleasure. And I realized the value of good ingredients, simple ingredients, and cooking with love and care. And really that set the foundation. And it was at that time that I had a turning point in my life where I realized that what I wanted really was always what I grew up with. And so I decided to ditch law and become a pastry chef. And then those days, there weren't very many women chefs. So, it was very exciting for me. And my parents never stopped me. They didn't even bat an eyelid when I told them that I wanted to be a chef. And they just asked me, are you sure? And I said, yes. And I eventually did become a pastry chef. Then I worked for the Oberoi Group of Hotels. And whilst trying to earn my place in the kitchen, I had a back accident. And I came back to Bombay to recover. And the doctors told me, I'm sorry, you can't be a chef anymore. You have to find an alternative career. And I couldn't imagine my life without food. I couldn't imagine cooking in a, my life without cooking in a professional kitchen. And I didn't want to be anything else. So I had to leave the Oberoi Group of Hotels, and then my family and I decided that we'd start something small for ourselves, just have a neighborhood shop. We wanted to bring what was at that time available only in five-star hotels out onto the high street. And, we wanted to make products that we ourselves like to eat. And so we decided that we'd start a small shop, make classic products, make them well, and use good ingredients. And that's how we started, really.
And that's exactly how it was. And not just food that you like to eat, but I think food that your friends like to eat.
Yes, we took lots of recommendations from you, Delna, that's for sure.
I was happy to be a guinea pig to try a lot of things. So, Tina, you are the eldest of the two sisters, a chartered accountant by profession. And not many people know that though Tina lives in London, she has her head firmly into the day-to-day operations of Theobroma, thanks to technology and thanks to her razor-sharp acumen. Tina is on the job every day with literally no days off and works even harder when she's on holiday back in India. And I've seen that firsthand. It is Tina's constant nudging and questioning about what's coming next, what's going next, what's going to happen next, that has kept Theobroma on its toes and growing from strength to strength. So Tina, my next question is to you. Your dad, Farooq Uncle, has always been an entrepreneur. In fact, both your parents have always been an entrepreneur. But I want to know, what have you learned from your father and what role did he play in the early stages of forming Theobroma?
So my dad funded the starting of our business. He gave us the entire amount as a loan. And it was a loan which we did not have to repay if the business was not successful. But the condition was that if we were profitable, we would have to repay the entire amount to charitable causes of our choice. That was the deal that he offered us. And my parents have always done a lot of charity. They do it quietly. And because of the success of Theobroma, we were able to repay that amount. The causes that we have supported have changed. My parents have always fed people, while I think now we've diverted more towards education of the girl child. And that comes from the fact that we grew up in a house where parental support and investment in our education was taken for granted. But we know that obviously everybody is not so lucky. So that's where, that's how we got started.
Kamal Messman, or Kamal Aunty, to many, many, many of us who have been fed and overfed in her lovely house, is the matriarch of the family, the original baker, the self-taught cook, the entrepreneur back in the days when there were such few women entrepreneurs, such few women in business. And this was way back in the 90s when Kamal Aunty started her business from home, making cakes and brownies and desserts, never imagining that her little baby will grow up to be what it is today. Some of the recipes, as Shyamala also mentioned, are being used at Theobroma, are Kamal Aunty's original recipes that were loved by her clientele, including me, back in the day. And some of the recipes date even back, even further back to her mother's kitchen. Kamal Aunty, in the book and in other media as well, you always say that Theobroma is a Parsi business. And you always speak about Parsi heritage. Theobroma's menu also includes several Parsi dishes. Why was this important for you? And at any point of time, did you feel that it was a risk to have so many Parsi dishes on the menu, being so niche? Kamal Aunty, I think you're muted. Just unmute yourself.
Hi.
Yeah, we are.
Oh, I can't hear very clearly, Kamal Aunty.
Wanting to put our home recipes onto our shop, and being a Parsi family, Theobroma is an extension of my Parsi business. And we opened our first shop in Khushrubagh, in a Parsi colony. Many of our earliest guests were also Parsis. The much loved brownie box of Theobroma, which was designed and conceptualized by lovely Elsie Nanji, has become a symbol of our brand and identity. The image on that box, which is of Khushrubagh, is framed and kept for display in every outlet of Theobroma, where my grandfather also lived in Khushrubagh, and so did my father. And I'm really very happy to be, and that was my first shop. Since then, we have now added so many more, but Khushrubagh remains the closest to my heart even today.
I think to many of us, the Khushrubagh outlet will always remain more special. At least I'm very biased about it, being from Khushrubagh myself. And I know how the opening was and how I wasn't there personally, but my family was there. And I know that how you had to literally stand on the footpath and celebrate the opening, because there wasn't any place in the store on the day it opened, because it was jam-packed and you just didn't anticipate the amount of people to come in the way they did. So I think you were definitely up for booming business from day one. Kamal Aunty, which is your favorite Parsi dish on the menu?
Even today, my favorite would be today, almond croissant, which we are unfortunately not making as of now because of the COVID, but hopefully we should have it someday again. And then there are lots of others like mawa cake, which was my mother's original recipe. And then we have the chicken mayo roll, where the mayonnaise is very bawas, because it's kind of sweet. And then we have the chicken crust patties. We have Parsi chutney bread. We have prawn patia bread, which was not very popular, so we had taken it off, but it was my favorite as well. And then we have, then for various Parsi occasions like the New Year and the Jamshedji Navroz, we bring in some of our Parsi favorites, like the chicken dhansa crab, the sali boti puff, then we make malido, Parsi malido tart, then we have egg and chutney puff, and we have akuri quiche. So we keep changing and kind of adding and subtracting things from our menu according to the demand.
I think you've got everybody's mouth watering now. It's choy time for me in Dubai, and I wish I could have one of these, honestly. Kainaz, I remember you were so keen to study law initially. You were determined to be a lawyer and, you know, study further. But yet life panned itself out in such a way that led you to fulfilling your dreams through this business. So what was your preparation like for this as an entrepreneur?
So actually, I did train professionally to be a chef. I graduated from IHM Bombay. I went to the Oberoi Center for Learning and Development. But I think when I look at my entire life, I think in hindsight, my entire life was built in preparation for a career in cooking. I remember very early on, even before we went, when we went to school, we would get up extra early in the morning to help mom with her home business. I remember sitting around our dining table, wrapping chocolates, and it had to be wrapped in a particular manner so that, you know, the surface area was all smooth. We used to pack the chicken rolls in small plastic bags, and the chicken rolls were, the plastic bag was just snug on the chicken roll. So the chicken roll had to go in a particular way. And if it didn't, it would smudge the plastic bag. And, we had to learn all those things. So we would help mom out packing all these orders before school. We would come back and mom would have orders for the next day, and we would be prepping, the desserts and things like that for the next day. My parents both ran their own individual businesses. They worked incredibly hard. They never asked us to work hard. They just, worked hard, and then we just simply followed their example. And we grew up in a business environment. We saw my mom run her own individual business. We saw my dad run his individual business. And the whole family coming together and helping those businesses. It didn't matter what our age was, whether we were 4, 5, 8, 10, or even 16 or 18. It didn't matter. We had to, help my parents in their businesses. It was nice to be a child and, start, get a head start into business, without in a protected environment. And I think those principles, of working hard, working with integrity, were instilled in us very early on. And so after I qualified to be a chef, even though in my head, I never wanted to be, never wanted to have my own business. I was so happy working in hotels at the posting that I had. I think it was just my destiny. And, that's how we started really. And, also what we learned was that it's okay not to have all the skills to start a business. It's okay to shout out for help when you need it. And it's okay to go outside of your family and outside of your comfort zone and bring in people who will help you and who have the same mindset as you and want to grow your business together. So I think these things, really helped us launch our business, even though we never had a plan of having such a big business.
Absolutely. And I really love, for those of you who don't have this book, I'm going to show my copy off, and it's signed by the author. So I love some of the things that you've written in the book. And I love how you especially so graciously accept the gaps and sometimes even the shortcomings that you have in the company. And honestly, that is, I think, the right attitude for growth. What started as one little cafe in Colaba to what it is now, 75 outlets in India today. I'm sure everybody wants to know What is your secret formula? What do you think that you did right, Kainaz?
So I think, I first of all, I don't think we did, you know, many things right. We made a lot of mistakes and we still make mistakes. I think a part of the excitement of a retail business is that you learn every day on the job. We, of course, didn't start to create a big brand or national brand across cities. I remember when we started, it was always, we had four tables and we were wondering how we were going to fill them every day, all day, because we had to pay rent, obviously, for the whole day and the whole month. But I think there were a few principles that we lived by. One was, I don't think that my focus ever shifted from the product. I realized earlier on that if we wanted to sustain the business, a focus on the product quality had to always be there. I think 17 years and into the business, and I still fret about my quality of my brownies, of my croissant, my bread, whatever. I can see every single day that I go to the kitchen, my first and my most important job is to check the product quality. And it is much more difficult than it sounds, because when you do things in bulk, it's not as easy as just multiplying the recipes and producing the same thing. Everything changes with every day because of weather and many different contributions. And also, even though we have a big business, my kitchen still operate as a artisan business. So all our products are handmade even today. I'm a little anal about not using packaged stuff. We manufacture everything on our own. We outsource very little in terms of bottled water, soft drinks. Really, the only real things that we outsource in our kitchen. Everything else is made by us in-house from scratch. And we don't franchise our brand, and we don't, we've shied away from, the many million offers that we get for franchising every single day, because I realize that this slows our growth a lot, but it helps us to maintain quality. If we can manufacture in our own kitchens under our own supervision, we'll do better. And so I think these few things have really helped us in good stead. They've helped us grow slowly, but at least it's helped us grow surely and in the way that we want to without diluting quality.
What about guest feedback? I mean, does that ever play a role in...
Absolutely, Dalna. Absolutely. I'm glad you asked that question. Guest feedback. I think one of the things that have helped us also is that we have managed to listen to our guests over the years, accept their feedback, take it positively, and work on improving our products and adapting it to their sensibilities. And so that has also helped us in good stead. We have, focused on evolving our product to suit our guest needs.
Right. I just want to remind you of one little story when we were sitting and having breakfast at the Colaba Cafe. And Kainaz, you, me, and my sister, we were sitting and having coffee, and behind us there was a table, there was a French couple, and there's so many tourists. For those who are not familiar with the Colaba outlet, there's so many tourists who keep coming in and trying on, trying the various things on the menu. And I remember there was a French couple sitting behind us talking in French amongst themselves about how a dish was not exactly what they expected, and then they called the waiter, and then Kainaz just popped her head back. She got up, started talking to the couple in French, and she churned out something exactly what they wanted. And I think they were just blown away and probably become your customers for life. So that is one such small story that I have witnessed. I'm sure there are many, many, many more of those.
Thank you, Dalna.
Tina, did you ever imagine that you would be running a business with your family? Even though you're geographically far away, you never let that come in the way of the business and the running of the business and anything, actually. You're so hands-on with this business. Tell us about the challenges that you have faced as a family, getting this together and holding it together.
You know, this business has been really, really difficult. Starting and growing a business is not easy. It's anything but. In fact, we always joke that if we knew how hard that this journey is going to be, I don't think we would have set out on the journey. Running a business is not only demanding and difficult. Each stage of this journey has brought with it its new set of challenges. And every phase that we've been in has felt like the most difficult time of our journey. And even though the problems change, we always have problems. We've just had to adapt to them, face them head on, and find solutions to them as best as we can. You know, when we started, we knew nothing about so many things. We had to do everything. Things that we were not ready for and that we were not prepared for. Where we didn't have the skill sets, we still had to do things. We had to take responsibility for everything. And whatever the problem was, it was our responsibility to set right. That was a big fundamental position that we had to take, and that has served us very well. You know, we've had to learn to accept criticism, feedback, you know, learn from our mistakes. Ultimately, we have to, when you get things right, you have to get more things right than you get wrong. And when you get things right, you then multiply those and do, you know, that takes you forward. Because, you know, everyone says we are an overnight success. And actually, when you look at an overnight success, it usually has decades of preparation and graft and hard work behind it. I mean, I don't believe in anything. I don't believe in the concept of overnight success. It's just that you've seen it and it appears to be overnight.
Yeah. I remember Tina as a college girl doing deliveries of brownies and heavy trays of, I think, sandwiches and various things to Cream Center, New Yorker. And I remember tagging along with her so many times and, you know, personally delivering all this for her mom's business. So I know for sure that this is not an overnight success. This has been, I mean, I think you've worked in it ever since you were born, probably.
Unpaid work, by the way.
She had to say that. I just want to pause here and tell everybody who's listening that if you have any questions, you can just keep typing it in the chat box and I'll be taking questions at the end. You can ask these lovely ladies any questions that you have in mind. I'm sure there are lots because they have so many amazing things to share, so many inspiring stories, so many hilarious stories along the way. So do type away your questions and I will go. I will go ahead. Tina, my next question is again for you. How do you ensure consistent growth? Because I know that is something that you're so pro at. You know, there's so many people who are not good with follow-ups. There's so many people who rise and then, you know, they meet status quo and they shy away, they drop down. But you're always on the game as a person, as a businesswoman. I have always seen how you never let go of the ball. You're always on it. So as a family-run business who had no plans whatsoever of becoming a national sweetheart, you have kept the wheels going. You all have kept the wheels going. And they say that failure is hard to deal with, but it's even harder to deal with success. So tell us more about this, how you kept it going.
You know, when we started, we knew how to bake cakes and not much else. I think we were totally unprepared for the retail business. We had to pull up our socks and learn everything else overnight. We worked together and each person in the family brought their different skills to the job, but we were still falling short. You know, things may have appeared calm to the guests and on the surface, but behind the scenes, we were paddling for our lives. We had, you know, by the time we reached 5 outlets, I would say we had outgrown the mom and pop shop in which we were working. And it was the time when we realized either we get professional help or we have to stop growing. Mm-hmm. So we needed professional help to transition us from this chaotic, sometimes dysfunctional way of working and take and bring, you know, give us structure and introduce process. It was a very hard decision for our family, especially my parents, because it was beyond just sharing equity. We as a family had to learn to give up control. You know, for a Parsi family, that is not an easy thing to do. We had to trust someone. We had to trust someone to partner on this journey with us who had the same sensibilities as us. So even though today Kainaz remains the final authority on product, on quality, we now trust and believe in our CEO and his leadership to take us forward. You know, we made that transition. And I think without that transition, we could not have reached where we are today.
Mm. That is true. That is true. So as Theobroma became this wonderful, amazing national chain of patisseries, its seeds were sown in the tender, loving care of a mother teaching her two daughters to be strong and self-sufficient. It really boils down to that. It really began there. And it is really as simple as that. I have known Tina and Kainaz to always be such self-assured girls as they were. I mean, I've known Kainaz, I think, since she was in the fourth standard. And always very confident and very self-assured in whatever she took on. And before the two of them even took on their chosen career path, which was, I think, Tina studied to her CA, Kainaz wanted to do her law. So you can see it was actually not a planned thing. But still, I always knew that these two friends of mine will always do something substantial for society. And I'm so proud to say that I was proved right. And I'm so proud of both of you. So I just want to, Tina and Kainaz, both of you, to tell us a little bit more about the mindset from the early days, especially about women being empowered to, you know, take on roles, take on leading roles in their own life, if you may.
So, you know, I think the biggest credit for that goes to our parents. My mom put us to sleep every night, telling us that we had to study, that we had to be independent, and that if life was not kind to us, we should be able to support ourselves and our children. She did not dictate to us what we could do or what we could not do, but she made it very clear that she expected us to achieve something. So I think, you know, this journey of women empowerment, women entrepreneurship, however you want to, self-assured women, it begins at home. You know, parents have to believe in their daughters. They have to have the same aspirations and expectations of their daughters as they have for their sons. You know, this is the first, most important and fundamental contribution we can make towards our daughters. We have to encourage them to dream, to make mistakes, and we have to invest in their education. Because, you know, the outside environment is changing. You see many more female role models now, you know, webinars such as this, everything contributes to it. But strong women, capable women are made in the home.
That's true. And I see your own daughter is very much into baking. And I see her Instagram with these amazing things that she bakes or buys. And I'm so happy to see that. Kainaz, do you want to add something?
My daughter's only interested in eating this month. not coming into the kitchen right now. But no, I have to resonate with everything Tina said. Strong women are first made at home. And we have to encourage our daughters not only to dream, but to dream big and follow their dreams. Allow them to make the mistakes. You know, allow them to fall. I see a lot of parents saying, oh, you know, we don't want our kids to do this because there's too much pressure, there's too much this. It's okay. They have to fail, and they can fail spectacularly before actually finding their place in society, finding you know, what they want to do, and you know, finding out how to do it well. These are you know, these are very important lessons. As much as you want to see your kids succeed and not give them the hardships that you might have faced in life, I think sometimes it's very important as parents to take that step back and just let them fall. You know, but obviously you have to know when to, you know, step in and protect your children and when to step back. It's very important to give girls the chance and, you know, just carry on that way, you know, let them become strong individuals.
Yeah, yeah. And boys too. Boys too.
Absolutely, absolutely. Kids as well. I see it with focus much more on girls because I know girls are at such a disadvantage in our country. And it's not only, you know, we often associate it with, you know, people who are not educated, are not educating their girls and so on and so forth. But the truth is that I've also seen it in homes where people are educated. You know, they've gone to the best schools, they have whatever it takes, but somehow they still manage to be unfair to their girls. And that is why my stress is more on the girls. It's not that... you know, this and as much as it's important to raise good, strong girls, it's also important to raise good, strong boys who will then in turn treat the girls right.
Absolutely. So, Kainas and Kamal Aunty, you can also add to this, please. What is your advice for the young girls and boys who are starting out on their own as entrepreneurs?
So I'll take the first part. I think for young girls and boys, my advice is that be prepared to work very, very hard. And you know, expertise doesn't come overnight. It doesn't come by just going to the best college, best school. You know, and you know, thinking that you come out as a rock star. When I went. I went to some of the best culinary schools. And I think when I came out, I thought that I was a chef, you know, a complete rock star. I could cook anything. I could do anything in life. You know, I was full of confidence, full of arrogance, I might add. You know, I could not have been more wrong. I thought I was the cat's whiskers and I knew everything there was about a bakery and pastry. Today, after running a business, I've realized that there is just no substitute for the job experience. It doesn't matter how long you've studied and from where you've studied. When you start working, be prepared to work from the bottom. Passion is something that you cultivate every single day. It's not a one-time thing. You can't say, I'm very passionate about food, for example, and then sit back the rest of your life and do nothing about that passion. You have to go back to it. You have to love it. Even when you hate it, there are days that it will take everything out of you. But you still have to go back and love it, you know, and cultivate it that way. Be prepared to start at the bottom. When kids come out of culinary school today and they come to me for jobs, you know, the first thing they say is that, you know, I want to be a cake artist. I only want to make modern entremets. I only want to make wedding cakes and so on and so forth. Nobody's interested in learning the basics, but it doesn't work like that, right? You cannot jump and say that you will become the best cake artist in the world if you don't know your basic cooking. And, you know, when I was in college, I was not allowed to specialize in either of my institutes, not in IHM, not in OCLD. I was told that I had to do everything. So whether it was Indian cooking, Chinese cooking, you know, housekeeping, cleaning the drains, cleaning the toilets of the hotels, whatever it was, I had to do it. And at that point of time, I probably resented it. But in my business today, I am so thankful that I have had that experience, because those are the paths that have helped me the most in my business. And I'm so grateful that I got to do that full, well-rounded education and not narrow my you know, ability to just doing pastry, because it has helped me tremendously in my business. So many times we would be working in the stores, and you know, when it was busy, guests would leave, and we would quickly clean up the tables. My mom would do it, you know, whoever was there from the family would do it. And some guests would say, oh, you're the owner and you're cleaning the tables. And I'm like, yes, so what? That's my job.
I've seen you doing that.
It doesn't matter. The job doesn't matter. Take every job as an opportunity to learn and to make and do that job well. Whether you want to do that job or not, you must do it well. And I think that is really the advice that I would want to give young kids to do.
That's such an important lesson. Actually, kids think that, they want it too easy. And it's so important to go through the whole drill to be fully grounded and fully rounded in what you're trying to learn.
Absolutely.
Kamal Aunty, you want to add something? Okay. Kainaz, I would like to take this. Is Kamal Aunty saying something?
No, move on.
Okay. Kainaz, if I may take the liberty, I would like to ask you something a little personal now, as I know it will be relevant to a lot of young Parsi couples who will be watching your interview. I know you have a cutest and most adorable little daughter who I miss, and I wish I could see her soon. But I know you've had your daughter through IVF. And there are a lot of young families who are scared or who are unsure of exploring this option. Would you like to talk about this a little bit?
Yes, of course. So when Nihal and I decided to start a family, it was not an easy process for us. We got married quite late. We didn't think that it was going to be difficult for either of us. We were in reasonably good health. We tried, of course, naturally, and then, for some time, and then nothing happened. So when we decided to take this opportunity, then we decided to start talking and taking medical advice, we realized that we would, need IVF to help us in this process. And I met many, many doctors. I struggled with all the, medical jargon, the overload of medical intervention and drugs being pumped into my body. It was not easy. I eventually did meet a doctor, Dr. Munjal Kapadia, and I tried IVF with him, because when I met him, I was somehow very, very comfortable with him. He put me at ease. He was really a sound support structure for me. He was there to counsel me every step of the way. His wife filled me with happy thoughts, happy books. She was such a great emotional support for me, because she herself had gone through it. And, it really helped me. So I think the first step is really to find the right doctor for you. If you are going down the IVF route. And I think the other very important thing, which many people ignore, I know that it's the hardest on the person going through the IVF is very, very hard. But having your partner's support, being empathetic to even what your partner is going through, it's not, yes, it is very difficult, and it is the hardest for the person going through the IVF, but also it is very difficult for your partner, going through the IVF as well, because they have to deal with mood swings, they have to deal with, looking at all the sort of suffering you're going through, the extreme physical pain, emotional pain, the disappointment every time you get a negative report. It's a hard journey. So support yourself, find the right doctor for yourself, support, get good support, treat it as a joint project together with you and your partner. That is very important. And take help from your family and friends. Speak about what you're going through, because of course they can't imagine what you're going through. Nobody can, unless they've gone through it themselves. But they want to help you, and they want to get you through this. So I think all's well that ends well. I'm unimaginably grateful for the daughter that I have, the family that she's made us. And I count my blessings every day. and really, really happy and thankful for my Nina. And, I thank God every day for it. Yes, it's a tough journey, but, it's all worth it. Every injection, every time the heart pain, the medical intervention at the end, it's all just worth it to see them grow. And, to see them happy is the best feeling in the world.
That's wonderful to hear. And that's wonderful advice to anybody out there who really wanted to hear this. So thank you for that, Kaina. Thank you for being so honest and vulnerable about this. I'm sure it really will help a lot of people. And since you always talk about support and you always talk about friendship, and I know how important this has been for all of you. I know how important friendship is for all of you. I mean, as a child, I remember Kamal Aunty always telling Tina, because I was always in the house with Tina, and she used to always say, you know, look after your friends. They are your biggest support. And I can see how you girls have carried that further in life, in business and in life. And, you know, this brings me to another story, support of another kind. Kainas, I love this story the most. I mean, I read it in the book, but I had heard it live in person when it actually happened. One of your ex-employees had shared his dream while he was working with you, I think, that he wanted to start his own bakery. And not only did you encourage him and you supported him, but you also actually went and inaugurated his bakery when he actually opened. I don't know too many business people who do this, and I really would love you to share this story with everyone.
No, I think, that employee, he's no longer an employee. He's my friend. His name is Ajay. He came to us as a young boy, just freshly graduated out of the cordon bleu in Australia, he came and he said, I just really love your business and I want to start my own bakery and patisserie, but I want to train under you. I don't want to train under anyone else. And, I just sort of dismissed him initially. And I said, listen, I don't have time to train people and things like that. We've got a full-blown job and it's a different kettle of fish. Working in India is completely different from, working anywhere else in the world. And, I don't have time for this. We'll talk. I'll talk to you, but I don't think you can work here. I don't think you'll survive, in the Indian business environment. And he just didn't move. He just sat there and he said, no, I'm not leaving without a job. I'll do whatever it takes, whatever you ask me, I'll do. And, I said, are you sure? Because I don't care what kind of fancy, hospitality school you went to. But at Theobroma, you're going to have to learn things right from scratch. And you're going to have to do things the Theobroma way. And he agreed. And I think till date, I have not met anyone who has understood this concept of working, in India is completely different from working in a foreign environment, in a foreign school. I don't think I've met anyone who has understood this more than Ajay. He really, really worked hard and the hardest I have ever seen any employee work. He never left the kitchen. He used to be there at 6. He used to, in the morning, he used to leave at like 12 at night. Rarely took days off. I was just so proud of him. He learned everything from scratch. He washed dishes. He did everything. And he never went home. Slowly he learned everything about the whole kitchen. He worked in every department. And then, I was wondering what I'm going to do without him, because, he did everything so well and he was a great support structure for me. Right. And it was also fun. We did so many projects together. And
so many other amazing stories, which I wish we had all the time in the world to discuss. But for those who want to hear more about these stories, please get the book.
Yeah.
Okay. I have to ask you one last question before we go into the question answer, because there are a whole lot of questions. Kainaz, what next? What is the future now for Theobroma?
So Della, I think now we are private equity funded, there's another whole company, that an institution that has put their trust in our brand, and we have a responsibility now to deploy that money in a manner which will befit their trust in us, which will help us maintain our product quality, because that is what really has made them invest in us as a business. I think this pandemic has been very difficult for us. It has set back the whole hospitality industry, and we are still trying to understand the impact it is going to create on our business in the future. We still have not understood the magnitude. It's been a huge setback for the entire industry, not only for us. And, now we have to control costs, but at the same time, we have to maintain product quality. We have to look after our staff. We have to look after our guests. Expansion or no expansion, these things are going to be constant. And so we have to just ensure that we put our head down, focus, and make the best of what we have. Make sure that we really, really uphold, the principles on what Theobroma was built on, and, make our investors proud, make our guests proud. My guests happy. Yes, that's the most important.
Thank you so much. We're going to be a little mindful of the time and go into our questions. Tina, my first question is to you. How was Theobroma named, and what does it mean? We all know what it means, but how was it named?
So I was working for a broking firm in London, and I spoke to Michael Dan. He was the head of commodity trading at FEMAT when I worked there. And immediately I told him about the name, that this is the business we want to start. And immediately, within a second, he told me Theobroma. And I said, what? And he said, that's the name of your business. And I was so unsure about it. In fact, when I told my parents about it, we were unsure. Everybody we suggested or mentioned the name to advised us to go against it. Mm. But it was an unconventional name, and we went with it. And I think it worked in our favor, because people had to put effort into remembering it. Theobroma now sounds like a familiar name, but it didn't at that time. Still get called all sorts of names, from the Obroma to the Obama to every possible combination of names. We have been called that, but it works. It has worked. It has created a unique identity for us, because until then everyone was Baker something, Cookie something, Brownie something.
Why don't you share the names you had in mind? The round square.
We had to play around with a few names. But they all got hit. All my suggestions got knocked on by you and the rest of my friends. Theobroma works for us. It not only does it mean food of the gods in Latin, it is also the botanical name of the cocoa plant. So it's very befitting for our brand.
Okay. Somebody is asking, though you have covered it in your answers earlier also, but have you ever thought of franchising?
Yes, we think about it all the time, and we turn it down. We get many requests from all over the world and from every city in India. We haven't gone down the franchising route, because it is not right for us. It would allow us to expand. It would allow us to grow, multiply our footprint many times over. But I think the honest truth is, we don't trust anyone to provide the same quality of product and the same service that we do. We struggle with it, so nobody else is going to care about it the way we do. We've turned it down for that reason.
All right. Adil Karakiwala is asking, congratulations on opening in South India. Hope Hyderabad outlet is doing well.
Outlets, we've got now 6 outlets in Hyderabad. And yes, we're it's doing very well, thank you. And we're also going to, fingers crossed, open in Bangalore later this year.
Amazing. Daddy Padamji is asking, Kainaz, I'm a fan of your products from Mumbai Pedder Road, but now in Delhi, your only outlet in South Delhi is STA Market. There was a small outlet in Vasant Vihar, the Artful Baker. They closed down last year during the pandemic. There is this space. I think it is a great market for your stuff in Vasant Vihar. Try to check it out, please.
We will. I'll be sure to tell my CEO that to look at Vasant Vihar for sure. Thank you.
Do you have any baking tips?
Oh, many, but we kind of difficult to capture it. You know, baking what exactly? The tips change with what baking we are doing.
Just cook from your heart, maybe. That's what you do.
I think also that baking is a little bit of science, so respect the recipe.
Right. Meghna is asking, why did you continue the lemon blueberry cake?
We have to discontinue things to make room for new things. We have to, get the lemon blueberry cake was for a short period. Since the pandemic, we've had to rationalize our menu because we have to make things that sell, that are the most popular. I love lemon and I love the lemon blueberry cake, but, it's not, lemon is not everyone's favorite. And so we had to make room for more things, but we'll bring it back at some point. We did do it for Diwali last year as part of an assortment of tea cakes.
Please add chocolate orange pot to that question. And you
can answer it. Yes, Delna, we all know that.
Elsie Nanji asks, how do you remain simple and thoughtful despite all the complications of creating a unique brand?
Hi, Elsie. The same as you. Exactly what you do, I do. No, Elsie is, how do we remain simple and thoughtful is by understanding that, I alone did not create this brand. I may be the face of the brand, but there are many, many people and many, many manas and people who have given their entire careers to this company to make sure that it works and it works well. I have to be more grateful to them because it's the team really that makes the brand. It's not one person.
Right. Akshay is asking, any plans to go international? When is Dubai outlet opening? We already know. So you better send us some stuff and answer that question with that. Do you do international deliveries, by the way? No.
No, we don't. Not yet.
Okay. Falmak is asking, who do you rate your biggest competitor as well as whom do you rate as the biggest culinary chef in India?
Well, culinary chef again. There are many, many great chefs. So, which chef are we talking about? Which cuisine are we talking about? There are many, but I have very, very deep respect for a lot of pastry chefs. My mentor, Chef Coelho, for me was the best chef in the world. He passed away sadly, earlier this year. But my favorite pastry chef in India today is Vikas Bagul. He runs a school called SEP in Andheri. Along with Chef Anil Roira, who, also teaches at that school. So for me, they are my ultimate Indian heroes, so to speak.
Right. Next question. What happened to magic moments? Come and
that's for mom to answer
that.
it died a natural death because we had a superior product.
Yes.
I think it's evolved. I wouldn't say it's dead.
But I'll revive it for anybody who wants it.
Theobroma is still a business today which has evolved from our mom's original business. So I think it's just transformed itself.
Right. Again, will Theobroma ever go overseas? Can it emerge as the patisserie equivalent to Starbucks?
No, I don't think, you know, I don't think we are looking at it as a Starbucks kind of thing. I would like Theobroma to, you know, retain its hominess as a home, you know, a patisserie that does things like we bake at home. So I'm very passionate about, you know, not using premixes, not using artificial gels and canned food, you know, semi-prepared stuff at Theobroma, even though it's easier to standardize this way when you brew big. It definitely makes your product look better and bigger and more attractive. I think, you know, the home style of baking is what really kind of sets us apart from other, you know, patisseries. And I'd like to retain that at least for now. I can't say too much about the future. You know, I don't know what it holds, but definitely for now, we are sticking to the home style of baking.
How do you manage food quality outside Delhi?
Sorry, say that again, Delna.
How do you manage food quality outside Delhi?
So outside Delhi, Theobroma started in Bombay. You know, our kitchen, we created a central kitchen in Bombay where we sort of did everything in-house. And then when we had to move to other cities like Delhi, Hyderabad, the way we wanted to control quality was by building our own central kitchens and making everything in-house. So my teams in Delhi, in Hyderabad, where we have our kitchen, you know, they are trained in the Theobroma way of baking. They firmly believe in that style of baking, that principles of baking. And so they uphold it. And, you know, we still make everything ourselves. So my team makes it and you know, that's it. That's how we, you know, maintain quality. It's not easy, but we try.
Amazing. So there are lots of people saying that they're big fans and everyone's giving their best wishes and their thanks.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Your blessings mean a lot to us. It is really what has held us in good stead. You know, we have so many fabulous stories, you know, of how our guests have come to our rescue so many times when we have been in trouble. And also so many guests who now we call friends. We've met so many wonderful people in our journey. And, you know, we felt like they are soulmates and they really have been become our lifelong friends now. So really, I want to thank everybody that has wished good for Theobroma, that have been our guests, you know, small or big, it doesn't matter. Thank you for your good wishes and thank you for your blessings, really.
Wonderful. So we'll wrap it up here, being mindful of the time. And thank you everyone for watching. Thank you, Jio Parsi, for having us. Thank you, Kamal Aunty, Kainaz, and Tina for your time and for sharing your story.
Thank you
so much.
Thank you, Jio Parsi, for having us. And thanks, thank you each one of our guests for making Theobroma the brand it is today.
Entirely our pleasure. And we wish we could have had more time. It's not as if
you
are,
you
know.
Thank you.
There's so much to ask and so much to learn. Anyway, thank you, viewers, for being such a wonderful audience. Join us next week again for yet another interesting session on our Friday forum. Binaifa Saukar will be talking about initiation with integrity, the Navarya ceremony. We will also have quite a few initiates into Parsi priesthoods on 11th June from 6 to 7 p.m. You can also follow us on www.geoparsi.org. Thank you so much. Stay safe. Take care. Thank you all.
Thank you. Thank you for having us.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thanks, Delna.
Thank you.
Thank you, Delna. Thank you, Shama. And thank you, the entire GeoParsi community. Thank you for having me.